as a metaphor. And in fact, the thing that changed my mind had nothing to do with rejecting the car as a metaphor. It was finding a better metaphor, that one that was completely possessed me. And that came about from seeing quite a different system. I had called the flex machine a personal computer. I think that was the first use of that term. And while I was trying to figure out what was wrong with it, I happened to visit RAND Corporation over here in Santa Monica and saw sort of a follow-on system to JOS that they had done for their end users, who were people like RAND economists. And these people loved JOS, but they hated to type. And so in the same year the mouse was invented, the RAND people had invented the first really good tablet. It was a high-resolution thing, and they decided that the thing to do was to get rid of keyboards entirely. And so the first really good hand character recognizer was developed there. And they built an entire system out of it called Grail for graphical input language. So there's no keyboard at all. You interacted directly with the things on the screen. You could move them around. If you did a square on the screen, if you drew a square, it would recognize you were trying to draw a square. It would make one. If you put in your hand printed characters, it would recognize them and straighten them up. And the system was designed for building simulations of the kinds that economists and other scientists would like to build. And using this system was completely different from using the Engelbart system. On this system, it felt like you were sinking your fingers right through the glass of the display and touching the information structures directly inside. And if what Engelbart was doing was the dawn of personal computing, what the RAND people were doing was the dawn of intimate computing.
And intimate computing, you forget that it's a machine and you think of it.
Yeah, you start. It, and one of the things that completely took hold of me in using the Grail system was it felt more like a musical instrument than anything. Because the musical instrument is something that most musicians don't think of their instruments as machines. And it's that closeness of contact, the fitness, that you're directly dealing with content rather than the form of the content that possessed me very strongly. And I saw, that was in 1968 as well, and I saw another several things. I saw Seymour Papert's early work with Logo, where here were children writing programs, and that happened because they had taken great care to try and combine the power of the computer with an easy-to-use language. In fact, they used the RAND JOS as a model and used the power of Lisp, which had been developed a few years before as an artificial intelligence language, put them together, and that was the early Logo. And to see children confidently programming just blew out the whole notion of the automobile metaphor. And the thing that replaced it was that this is a medium. This is like pencil and paper. We can't wait until the kids are seniors in high school to give them driver's ed on the thing. They have to start using it practically from birth the way they use pencil and paper. And it was destined not to be packaged on a desktop, because we don't carry our desks with it. It had to be something much smaller. And that was when I first started seriously thinking about a notebook computer. And of course, the first thing I wanted to know, after deciding that it had to be no larger than this, was when would that be possible, if ever? And so I started looking at what the integrated circuit people were doing, Gordon Moore and Bob Noyce and stuff, and there were these nice projections that they, as confident physicists, had made about where silicon can go. And what's wonderful is these projections have only been off by a few percent now, more than 20 years later. And of course, I was very enthusiastic. I would believe anything that was in the right direction. So I took this hook, line, and sinker and said, okay, 20 years from now, we'll be able to have a notebook size computer that we can not only do all the wonderful things on computers, we can do mundane things too, because that's what paper is all about. You can write a Shakespearean sonnet on it, but you can also put your grocery list on it. So one of the questions I asked back in 1968 is, what kind of a computer would it have to be for you to do something so mundane as to put your grocery list on it, be willing to carry it into a supermarket, and be willing to carry it out with a couple of bags of groceries? There's nothing special about that. You can do it with paper. So the question is, see, the question is not whether you replace paper or not. question is whether you can cover the old medium with the new, and then you have all these marvelous things that you can do with the new medium that you can't do with the old.
Now, many people find the idea of a medium a tricky concept. In the sense you're talking about writing and so forth, or music, what do you mean?
Well, I think most of my thoughts about media were shaped by reading McLuhan, which not everybody agrees with, but one of his points is that the notion of intermediary is something that is not added on to humans. It's sort of what we are. We deal with the world through intermediaries. We can't fit the world into our brain. We don't have a one-to-one representation of the world in our brain. We have something that is an abstraction